Hello, dear friends. My name is Dr. Vishal Soni. I'm a consultant laparoscopic surgeon at the Zydus Hospital, Ahmedabad. The COVID-19 pandemic has changed the way we live, changed the way we behave, the way we eat, the way we interact, and essentially the way we operate also. There are plenty changes that need to now get inculcated in our surgical habits so that the surgical results do not suffer. My today's talk would be focusing on the various guidelines that have come up, namely by CGs, the ACS and RCS, to make sure that our surgeries are safer and the patient interests are preserved, and how to tide over the crisis in the best possible way. Hope you find my talk and the content informative. Best of luck. Stay safe.
Now, for all the surgeons who are watching the video and haven't been assigned any intensive care responsibilities yet, the restlessness and the pain is very well understood, my friend. In the next 20 odd minutes, we would learn the various conclusions that surgical teams have arrived at while delivering surgical care during the current COVID-19 pandemic. With the global level of involvement and the crisis thus generated, the pandemic has created sort of a medical world war. Allow me to call this a World War C, of course, sans the bloodshed. And with our dear physician colleagues being in the forefront of the care and fighting this war. I have no disclaimers to make as such. The logos show the sites from where my source material has been procured. Now, this pandemic has proven to be a litmus test for a lot of processes and methodologies that we follow. The pressure on medical bodies to come up with clear but yet safe recommendations has been a very mammoth task. However, not everything that comes on the paper or on your screen is necessarily black or white distinctively. There are plenty distractors to the truth, if I must say that way, influenced by geography, the economics, and the politics of the country of origin. The current inputs, at the best, should be taken as very informed guesses and estimates, which are heavily influenced by our past experiences. And all this is marred by the changing narratives. Let me give you an example to prove my point. Now, as shown here in this paper originating from China, this has challenged the presumed source and the exact occurrence and the timing of the initial outburst of cases in the city of Wuhan. I leave the conclusions to you, but the important part is we expect such more changes to happen as the time passes by. Now, this is for the restless lot. The slide is a clear hint with a message regarding possibility of performance of surgeries, of course, with a few clauses and conditions to be followed. My talk would focus on the processes involved and the detailing. Things haven't been so clear from the beginning of the pandemic, and the initial reaction from the surgical fraternity was understandably very negative to begin with. But there has been a steady adaptation to these challenges and the changing perspectives. So a no is slowly and steadily becoming a yes. We haven't reached there yet, but I believe soon we'll reach there. Beyond critical care, the surgical services are economic workhorses for any private healthcare. Hence, any interruption would deserve tremendous attention. We now discuss the current hindrance of COVID-19 pandemic under the following headings. The virus being a very infectious agent, there is an ill-defined pre-symptomatic period, there are diagnostic challenges world over, there is a possibility of intraop aerosolization, and finally, the effect of surgery on the patient, which has been a little discouraging as we see from the papers coming from China. I would like to draw your attention to the fact that the patient harbors the virus in various body compartments and body fluid, which makes the task of containment extremely challenging. Beyond the respiratory tract and the GI tract, there has been isolation from the conjunctiva, the blood, and also the urine. Although the initial papers were negative, the follow-up papers have isolated the virus even from the urine samples. Here, beyond the respiratory tract, GIT plays an important role in influencing the presentation and possibly the transmission as well. Nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, abdominal discomfort can be seen in up to one-third of the patient, typically followed by typical respiratory symptoms. Therefore, even abdomen cases can be COVID-19. Depending on the local prevalence of the disease, they should be kept in mind while seeing abdomen patient. Mind you, the first case in USA had an atypical presentation with nausea and vomiting followed by loose motion. The infectious period where the patient can transmit the disease is extremely long, from 15 to 35 days, and this is when fecal transmission has been seen. Now coming to the preparation of the pandemic, the decision-making flow would essentially be from top to down, so the institutional level all the way to the individual department. As shown here, we are yet in the alert phase, and with adequate time at hand, have absolutely no reason not to handle this well. I'm happy to say that we at Zydus Hospital have achieved all the goals in the list. Management of patient department-wise, this is a very simplistic flow of thoughts with three stations. The first being categorization of the surgical disease at hand into a stable or an unstable disease. Unstable disease being on very high priority for further steps, including an urgent surgical intervention. Stable disease would then be subjected to consideration of the current stage of epidemic locally into a growing viral pandemic versus a plateau or a declining phase. And lastly, the COVID status of the patient, negative or a positive. We further have structured guidelines to help us in individual decision making with regards to the pathology. Here's another flowchart based on the IAGS recommendation, whereby the surgical patient can be seen as an emergency or an elective case. The emergencies go straight away to OR and elective gets delayed. But then there would be a bunch of cases which are somewhere in between. Then there is a series of questions that need to be answered to come to a logical conclusion regarding whether this patient needs surgery or can be safely delayed. We have elective surgery acuity scale by Siddiqui from the St. Louis University. It divides the surgery into three tiers, the third tier being the highest. Most cancers, surgeries which include pathologies with compromised bowel or visceral integrity or trauma with hemodynamic instability would fall in the tier 3, and they deserve urgent surgical care and should be treated accordingly. Cancer ceases to be an elective case and should be seen as an urgency. Moving to the preoperative investigations in these patients, RT-PCR performed on the nasal swabs has come to pretty much of limelight, but the issues regarding restricted test kits availability in various countries makes me wanting to talk on CT chest as the point of focus here. CT chest possesses a very high sensitivity for diagnosis of COVID-19. Not only it is very accurate, but even when there is initial RT-PCR negativity, the CT scan has managed to pick up the positive findings in the patient and has been a problem-solving modality. Another study here focusing on the fact that the modality being a very common in-house test available, the turnaround time can be very short, and in a matter of few hours, a definitive diagnosis can be at hand. I would now discuss the specific recommendations by international surgical bodies with respect to surgical interventions. After initial scare, the data that came in has been a little positive, and there are surgical teams who have managed to perform surgeries safely, and these are the recommendations from them. There has to be an explicit consent covering the risk of COVID-19 during the surgery or post-surgery in the recovery period. The pre-operative testing has to be very extensive. Each patient should be presumed positive, and it has to be job of the team handling the patient to pick it up. All the anesthesia steps, namely intubation and the extubations, must take place in a negative pressure room, that is in the OR. The staff involvement in the surgery should be minimum, with no exchange of the staff if the surgery is of a short duration. The PPE use should be guided as per the local hospital or national protocols and must involve each and every member of the team. The electrosurgery devices, namely the cautery, the harmonic, or the CUSA, should be used at the minimum or the lowest possible settings and strictly with smoke evacuators. An important reminder here is the fact that if a non-operative management is possible, for example, in early appendicitis or acute cholecystitis, this should be implemented. Broad stand regarding minimally invasive surgery is still positive, as there is no solid evidence against use of minimally invasive surgery in COVID-positive patients yet. There is a concern regarding increased generation of aerosols in MIS, but pneumoperitoneum being a closed cavity, the handling of smoke and aerosols is better achieved, and therefore it might have an upper hand over open surgeries. Other benefits like lesser pain, earlier return to work, and earlier discharge hold true. The usage of PPE remains the same as in open surgery. Finer details regarding change in these steps would be discussed in later slides. The literature on use of robotic surgery in COVID-19 pandemic is still pretty sparse. Nonetheless, the logical extension of risks and benefits of minimally invasive surgery should hold true. We have one such paper here from countries with comparatively low number of cases, that is Germany, Denmark, and Netherlands, with little encouraging results. Few more recommendation templates. This one is from SAGES and EAES jointly, which underscore the practical measures, which include the specific consent, as I mentioned prior, and all the testing should be extensively done. One point to be noted is attachment of a filtration device for released CO2. Here we have a template from the Royal College of Surgeons. It shows the importance of adding a CT thorax for all the patients, even in cases of emergency. It also shows that one should be thinking about risk reduction strategies. Example, stoma formation vis-a-vis formation of a precarious anastomosis. Risk points have already been discussed. Apologies for a very busy slide here, but I believe this is how things are going to be complex. As you can see here, the COVID status of the patient has been placed very high up in the management algorithm, and the next steps follow after that. Of course, if it's an emergency situation, things are a little different, but nonetheless, knowing the status helps. Further decisions regarding non-operative management versus open surgery versus minimally invasive surgeries, the decision can be taken then. This slide would focus on the small surgical steps that need to be taken care of while doing minimally invasive surgery. The incisions need to be the smallest possible so as to prevent any periportal leak. As far as possible, air seal port should be used. The CO2 pressure should be very minimal. 8 millimeters of mercury should be adequate. The instrument exchanges should be minimized. One modality is by using an extra port. So a 4-port can become a 5-port surgery. There should be a dedicated insufflation port. There should be a dedicated port for filtration device so that the carbon dioxide exits safely. The desufflation should be carried out actively as opposed to a passive letting off to the atmosphere. The specimen removal should strictly be done after the carbon dioxide and smoke evacuation has got completed. One should avoid drain placement and usage of port closure devices or Hall's ports, as there is a lot of peri device leaks seen. Ending my surgical recommendations with a visual thought map reinforcing the flow. The points on which it is based would be urgency of the surgery, the anticipated viral burden in the patient, the opportunity of aerosolization of the virus and the patient symptoms and the testing for the same. The steps to follow would be prioritizing the patients, of course, conserving the person protective equipments, and protecting the OR team at all the steps. Busy slide here, which focuses on a very small detailing in the micromanagement of the workflow in the OR that has been already thought of. So various stakeholders, namely the in charge, the runner, the assistant, the anesthesia team, the technicians, and the steps that they need to do preoperatively during the surgery and post-op have all been defined very well. And I believe if these are followed very religiously, then we can prevent the movement of the infection from the patient to the healthcare providers either ways. When we talk of PPE, two points should be absolutely thought of. That is, due use in each and every patient and the scarcity in its availability. When we say full PPE, we mean complete coverage with a cap, an N95 respirator, goggle or a face shield, a gown and nitrile gloves. Interestingly, the shoes aren't discussed much, but nonetheless should be used in each and every case. Here we can see the surgical team using powered air purifying respirators. The OR should have minimum possible equipment, and all the equipment that is there need to be covered, more so because after every surgery, it will need surface decontamination, surface sterilization. Plastic sheet use is recommended.
This is a laminar flow operating theater used in orthopedic surgery. We are using helium bubbles to help us visualize how air flows around the room. If laminar flow were working properly, these bubbles would be cleared away in seconds. This is how it should look. We're using the same bubble generator in the same room, and we've made no changes to the setup of the room. Laminar flow is working. It's clearing the bubbles away before they have a chance to accumulate and circulate. The only thing we've changed in the laminar flow zone is the position of the operating lights. What this means is that while you may be in a laminar flow operating room, you may not be under laminar flow. Operating lights can block the operative field.
We talked about smoke evacuators. Here is a makeshift arrangement whereby the suction tubing is attached to the cautery pen, and it helps in evacuation of the smoke exactly where it is generated. A very interesting way to do it. This is a very remarkable paper originating from Singapore, detailing the adaptations that the hospital undertook at various levels in handling the pandemic. Of note is the placement of PPEs at the least effective as the least effective modality in prevention of the exposure hazards. You see, the engineering control and administrative control would actually score better as compared to PPE in preventing the exposure to COVID-19. Very interesting paper from the city of Wuhan, from where multiple hospital patients which were operated in the month of January for various illnesses ended up developing clinical disease of COVID-19 with a very short duration. Post-operatively, we know that these patients, they already had the infection when they were being operated. Now the outcomes are pretty bad. The timing for onset of symptoms, from the symptom initiation to onset of dyspnea and from there to death, is all very less. And towards the negative side, there is an extremely high mortality of about 20%. So 7 of 34 patients did not go home. So we know that the stress of surgery somehow contributes to the cytokine storm that happens in these patients, and they somehow don't do well, and the results are inferior in elective surgeries. We have some similar negative sentiments and negative outcomes coming in from other countries which have been badly hit, namely Italy and Iran, where post-operatively the patients just did not do well. Going back to the country which has been very badly hit with the SARS-CoV-2 infection, Here is a nationwide analysis of the oncology subset patients. Now, be it surgery or chemotherapy, adjuvant chemotherapy wise, these patients, they did not do well as compared to the non-cancerous or the cancer survivor patients. So what we know is that when you operate these patients, they don't do well, and you must rethink regarding the surgical options very carefully. I believe this phrase would need no explanation. This should serve as a gentle reminder to promote sound surgical decisions in each and every of our patient. I would further go on to say that it's duty of a surgeon to protect himself and the staff, of preserving the patient interest and protecting the hospital resources. Some inputs on the endoscopy side. Since there is tremendous amount of shedding of the virus in the upper GIT and also in the feces, each and every procedure endoscopically becomes a high-risk procedure. Even a mundane task of putting a Ryle's tube can be considered, should be considered as an aerosol generation procedure, and protection should be taken accordingly. EMR and ESD, all the advanced procedures should be absolutely avoided, and usage of surgical energy, the guidelines are just like any other open surgery or laparoscopic surgery. The endoscope should be covered just the way we cover the laparoscopes. The orifices from which we enter in, namely the anus or the mouth, should also get a cover so as to prevent air leaks and aerosolization, and also to prevent spillage of the contents. The data regarding transplantation is still pouring in. We have at least one such paper which says that the transplantation services may continue if the other surgical advices are followed and the donor status, either it is known explicitly or during harvesting of the organs, the BAL is performed and the testing is done. We'll conclude my scientific lessons with this illusion, whereby the arrow is the data that we see as of now. And the initial tweaks, they all suggest that things are okay and we can go ahead. But let's analyze it further. Let's wait for some more time. Probably review it in a stronger way so as to make sure that the only way ahead is surely forward and it is safely forward. We have global platforms now for collaboration of the data. These sites, they are pooling in data from all over the world regarding the outcomes of the patient, surgical patients which are COVID positive and surgeries were done. I wish I could have answered all the questions that are being generated, but the fact is I'll leave you with more questions. These are questions with answers in the future. Is there any COVID specific chemo prophylaxis for surgical patient? Answer is no as of today. Now, rest of the questions are, what happens if you're doing elective or semi-elective work and the situation change? So what if the patient needs a post-operative ventilatory support or ICU requirement? Would it still be feasible to do during this epidemic era? What about surgeries with a possible or an anticipated complex post-operative course? Should you be posting them? What about COVID-19 disease during recovery from an elective surgery? We just saw a few papers and the results are very discouraging. What if there is a sudden change in the stage of epidemic in the post-operative period and the hospital gets overwhelmed with the surge of patient? What about COVID-19 as a hospital-acquired infection, the medico-legal and the financial implications? And how frequently should the healthcare providers be tested? The last point is for self-evaluation. These are my suggestions and a summary of the entire journey. So surgical interventions only if explicitly beneficial. At least 2 days of IPD stay for semi-electives and a special consent to be sought, swab and scan, absolutely. A designated laminar flow OT should be available. There should be a primed team which would know what is happening. Adaptations in the anesthesia end are a must. There are protocols to follow. Both open and laparoscopic surgery are very much feasible. MIS is possibly better. Daycare surgery should be offered, and we might see a surge in the same. And purely electives to be deferred for at least a period of 3 months. Now, as we progress in the epidemic, we might have to make some finer changes in the same and adapt to the situation. If you have reached to this slide, I believe you are someone who seeks a lot of answers, just like me. And in that case, I really thank you to be part of this journey. Thank you. Take care, stay home, stay safe.